Before we get started, just a quick note, spoiler alert.
And we are adults, and I will try very hard not to use adult language, but this is the warning.
Actually, will you do that again? You went, hello, ro, ro, ro.
Oh.
Hello and welcome to Fright Bites. My name is Jennifer.
And I'm Serena. Each episode, we will feature a short story or novella. You can read along with us by finding the full reading list posted on our website, lastlibraryontheleft.com, or our social media at LLOTLpodcast.
And today we are talking about The Last Final Girl by Stephen Graham Jones. It was published in 2012 by none other than Stephen Graham Jones.
Huh, the one I got from the library says that it was published by Lazy Fascist Press.
Oh, okay. Because yeah. In the book, I saw Stephen Graham Jones. I'm like, what? Okay, great. And the summary is very small and short. And yeah, life in a slasher film is easy. You just have to know when to die. It goes on from there, the summary, but that's all you need to know.
Yeah.
I do want to stand a little bit for the front cover. I like front covers that are black and have minimal wording. The wording that they use is very contrasting. Like Bedfellow, I love that cover because it was a black cover with just red lettering. So I like this too. But just looking at it, this was on my list of books to read for October anyways. And we ended up having to cover it because one of the books I think was too long, right?
Right. I think I got My Heart is a Chainsaw mixed up with something else.
We'll eventually read that anyways. But yeah.
David gave a weird tilt of his head at that title. Yes, Chainsaw is part of my heart.
yes. So the front cover I really liked because at the very top it says you screamed with scream, you dressed up for Halloween, you went camping on Friday the 13th, and you stayed awake for Nightmare on Elm Street. Now shimmy into that skirt, pick up whatever blade's handy, it's time for, and then it goes to the title, The Last Final Girl. But at the very bottom, there's a quote, which normally the quotes are from Publishers Weekly or some like notable person saying how great the book is. This quote is actually from the movie Scream, and it says, movies don't create psychos. Movies make psychos more creative. And it was by Billy, one of the killers from Scream. If you haven't watched it, shame on you.
Okay, thank you for telling me that, because I read that and was like, who the F is Billy? Is he a literary Cher? Billy from Hocus Pocus? What is happening here?
And that's how I knew what the plot was going to be. So this quote actually happens towards the end of the Scream film, the first one, when you realize who the killer actually is. And it's Billy, which is the main character's boyfriend at the time. And he was assumed dead at that point by the killer. And he comes back to life and he's like eating the blood that was on his body because it was made from corn syrup. And so that's when he says something about movies don't create psychos. Movies make psychos more creative. As he's revealing his whole plan and having his little, you know, villain monologue.
I guess that means that y'all know my secret now. I've never actually seen Scream or I Know What You Did Last Summer.
And those are all in my wheelhouse.
Which is why I enjoyed the book, but I think I only enjoyed it because I imagined you narrating the book to me.
When you told me that, I was like, that's so sweet.
Yeah, I got one page in and put the book down to write notes, but I was like, if this is gonna work, I need to approach this book different from the rest of the list. No notes. Imagine being in a theater with Jennifer as she gushes about her favorite things in horror.
Yeah. So, okay, reading it was kind of tough for me, and that's because it's set sort of screenplay-ish, and reading a screenplay is different because they tell you who the character is, and then they have, in the parentheses, they have what they're doing and stuff, so it's a little bit easier to read a screenplay, whereas this one has abrupt arrows pointing you to something else. So it was a little bit jarring at times, but I did read in some of the reviews for people to utilize the audiobook.
Yeah, I read that too.
Right. And so I would say go ahead and like listen to the audiobook and maybe use that as your frame of reference when you're reading it. Part of the different jumps I felt were meant to be jump scares, and it didn't necessarily scare me, but it did kind of like discombobulate me a little bit. And I was like, well, I guess you disoriented me and that's what you were trying to do, so good job. But they're very quick cuts. And that's the only negative I would say about this. Another negative I would hit this with is if you're not a fan of slasher movies, the amount of references there are to slasher films and 80s pop culture, if you weren't like around during that time and you're not into that throwback, you're not gonna like this book.
Yeah, I got some of the names maybe in reference, like Crystal Blake was Crystal Lake.
Yeah.
So that's the thing, though, since I've never actually watched any of these movies through and through, except for maybe bits and pieces here and there, I only picked up on these things I'd seen in memes.
Yeah, yeah. And so I have been personally debating on starting a blog of all the books that I read, going in depth with them.
Ooh, yeah, you should.
I think this one might be the first one I go into because I tabbed just the amount of references that were made, and you could create a movie list out of, well, you could create several movie lists out of the references that were made in the book. And I think when I finally do get the decision to make a blog, this will be the first one I cover, including all of that stuff. It's too much to cover in this episode, so I just picked out some key points.
There's that much?
There's that much. Halfway through the book, I stopped and I'd already had 50 tabs.
Oh my god, really?
Yeah.
That's insane.
I couldn't keep them all in because I was like, there's no way that I could cover all of the pop culture references and the slasher references. Like, let me just pick out some of the main ones that I really liked and go through. And that's why it took me so long to get my notes together.
I can't wait. I can't wait. This is one I've been waiting for, knowing like Jennifer is going to school me on this book. I bet for every tab you have, that was a moment that as I was reading, I thought to myself, I just missed something important, didn't I?
And yeah. So let's just go ahead and start with the very beginning because it separates yourself into three different acts. I'm not going to give you all of the coverage of all of them because it's just a great, it's a great little storyline if you want to read it. We open up on this one girl who is running away from the killer who ironically is dressed up in a Michael Jackson costume that I just found, it tickled the hell out of me. And they're playing Thriller in the background. Just so weird. I was like, what the fuck? Okay. And one of the things that they did is they really set her up to be a final girl. Because if you're not familiar with the final girl trope, she's usually someone who is pure and chaste, usually a brunette. Oftentimes she's wearing light colored clothes in the movies, and she's usually going through a hell of a lot of shit to come out towards the end. And she might also die at the end, but she will be the last girl to die. Normally she comes out alive, albeit very, very damaged. Mm. And I wrote a blog article for our library website about the final girl trope and like with some book recommendations. And so just going to give you a little shot. If you are not familiar with the final girl, think of the Little Red Riding Hood because she is a final girl.
Oh my god, Jennifer, I've never thought of kids' fairy tales as having a final girl in them.
Yes. Well, I included that in the blog article because I was like, people don't really know that there are final girls in like all sorts of literature and feature films. And like, it's only just in horror, but the Little Red Riding Hood is one. Anastasia is one.
Oh my god.
Gretel is one. So, you know.
You know what? I'm not even going to lie. You kind of picked me up about this.
So the final girl is everywhere.
Wow.
So
okay, no, like you don't understand. You kind of broke my brain a little because I'm like, wait, now I have to reframe so much of the research I did for my degrees.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, I think we're so trained to think of the final girl as just a horror or a thriller type trope, but she's everywhere. So, you know, And that was why I wanted to write that little article and with the book recommendations. So I was like, I just want to show you something.
Well, now I have to go read your article.
Yeah, I mean, it's just basic, but it was a good little introduction and I might cover more later on. And that's why I was testing it because I was like, maybe when I do like a personal one, I'll go in depth with that trope because the final girl is one of my favorite tropes. So anyways, going back to the book actually sets up multiple final girls into the plot and you quickly realize that the main final girl, Lindsay, is setting this up for whatever reason. We don't know if it's just to showcase different final girls, bring them to the spotlight because she's a final girl now. You find out later in the book. But each of these final girls have actually been debunked as the final girl, right? One of them, she's pierced and she's like very knowledgeable about things and she's really outspoken, which the final girl usually isn't. There's another one who they call her Candy Cane because she's kind of a little promiscuous. So they kind of debunk each of the final girls. And the setting is it's the homecoming dance and they're all in the homecoming court because the previous court all died when Lindsay became the final girl in her story. And each final girl Girl is actually a final girl. They have different backstories. For instance, the main character, Izzy, who we get a lot of the book in her perspective, her twin brother died. And so she was the final girl in that situation. She survived what he didn't. So it goes from there. It's really, really good. Some of the things that I picked up on were that Jamie Curtis was, I knew from the beginning he was a reporter. And I knew that Jamie Curtis was fake because that's a fake name. And that was from Jamie Lee Curtis, yeah. The actress. Yeah.
Wait, how did you know that Jamie Curtis was a fake name?
So I knew it because the name Jamie Curtis, I was like, no, that can't be his real name. They made the mention of, oh, you're just missing the Lee for Jamie Lee Curtis. And then they start talking about all the movies she's in. And I was like, oh, there's a red flag there. He's not someone who you should trust.
Wow, I am so dumb.
Okay.
It's so funny because she's a famous final girl. Like, we all know her. She's a famous final girl. So I was like, no, that's a red flag.
Wow.
I also noted the teacher that was talking to Izzy about her papers. There's a moment where she has an interaction with a teacher and the teacher is telling her, oh, you know, you need to be more like your classmates and write more topics about Jane Austen-like stuff rather than the horror stuff that she's writing. And then you later find out that two girls have been reading her papers all along. And I'm skipping through a whole chunk of the plot to say that you realize that the two final girls, Lindsay and Crystal, I believe, have been grading the papers. And they've been using the material in Izzy's papers to help them further along their agenda because their agenda has never been pure.
Yeah.
And so it's so fun the way this book went out, but it was written very chaotically. They do in the book, they also talk about the final girl trope. They mention it a lot. And they also mention that Izzy mentions a lot that she knows that she's in a horror movie right now. She knows that what she's encountering in school with the death of Lindsay's classmates and a sheriff ends up dying. She knows that she's in a type of horror movie, but she's like, it's not a slasher film because with a slasher film, her and her friend Brittany, they're like, there have to be dead bodies everywhere, which is accurate, and that comes later. But also, Izzy has a relationship with the killer, which I found was really odd. And I think that was a red herring, that whole like plot twist. There's an incident where Izzy runs into one of the sheriffs and the sheriff is drinking and the sheriff ends up accidentally dying. But while that's occurring, Izzy encounters Billie Jean, who they've nicknamed the killer because of his Michael Jackson mask. Mm-hmm. And throughout the novel, Izzy is sort of taking care of the killer. Like, she's gotten him a cast because I guess his leg is messed up and she's like feeding him burritos and just in typical like slasher killer style, like he's not talking, he's just kind of looking at her like he doesn't understand what she's saying. And I kind of didn't really get that whole, I didn't get any of that.
So I kind of figured that was like, now I could be 1,000 bases off because this isn't my shtick, but that I did see a reference for because it makes me think of those women who write love letters to serial killers.
Oh, that's a good point. That's a really good point. Because the only thing I could think of was they're trying to show that she's compassionate.
But yeah, no, it was so toxic, right? Because like those women who write those letters, they try to claim those psychotic men they're convinced to love them back are just, you know, misunderstood. Okay, so I actually got one thing out of this.
You did great, and you got something that I didn't catch because I'm thinking like, why is this in here? Like, I don't need to see this. You could have pulled it out, I would have been fine.
So we have our strengths.
Yes, I like that interpretation because that definitely brings it to light for me. I also wrote down April, which is the unsuspecting nerd. And when she passed by Lindsay in the hallway, or Lindsay talked to her for a minute, and then she encountered the girls in the library. I was like, she's here for some reason, and I don't know why, but I wrote her name down. And in true horror fashion, she sets off the bloodbath that comes in later in the book because she's the unsuspecting nerd who all of a sudden turns very sexual and does a lot of stuff. And if you know the horror films from the 80s taught you lessons, you don't go out late at night, you don't go out with the wrong crowd, and you don't have sex. So the minute she had sex, that was when all the murders started taking place, which, by the way, that's very sexist. I'm just going to put that out there.
Oh, yeah.
another thing that I really loved is how they randomly decided to put in Robert Englund and I can't remember the guy's name who played Candyman as head coaches for the opposite school. And I was like... And that's when I stopped taking notes, because like, I think I just need to enjoy this now. So that's all I have for my notes, but I did write down actual quotes.
Oh, yes, please.
So the first quote that I wrote was, slashers make final girls come into their own, because this book centered around Izzy, but you got a lot of the other final girls and what made them strong in their own sense, which I really liked. This one was so good. And this one, I think I might get on a t-shirt. It says, but everything's horror, isn't it? Sometimes you just can't see the blood. And I wrote, like, that's perfect for our podcast, because we put horror into everything and we can find horror in everything.
It's a gift.
That was a really good one. And then another one that just kind of like gave me the chills. It's not bullets or fire or telekinesis or lighting or sequels that kill a slasher. It's being unmasked. And revealing their true selves. Like, ooh, that was really good.
Yeah.
Then also the next one I put down is that, which this gives away a lot of the plot. This is when Izzy realizes what Lindsay's true motives are. And she writes, she's setting it up so she's the final girl of all the final girls. And I really loved that one. That one was really good and really dark, because this whole time Lindsay's portrayed as pure and just the best of the best. And, you know, she's feeding into it. But there are moments in the book where, like, for instance, there's a moment where her homecoming date, Jake, is going to pull a book out of his backpack and he pulls out a gun. And rather than like having some sort of trauma response, Lindsay looks kind of disinterested. And I was like, what happened, Lindsay? Like, I kept wondering, like, girl, are you okay? Because in the book, she's like 10 days out from the past trauma. So like, she didn't heal that quickly.
That actually made me think of Scream Queens. Have you watched that yet?
I have not watched that one yet. It's on a list on my list of things to watch.
I think you'd really enjoy it. I mean, I liked it, but I think that after watching it, you would have even more places to put tabs in that book.
Yeah. Like you with Ellen Haven, like this book, I bought a copy and I think I need to buy another copy that's like going to be the copy that I use my research into, because it was, oh gosh, there's just so much.
Did you know that you can be a scholar of horror?
Oh my God. This book made me want to be. It definitely had me going there, because I had never read a book where I got so much out of it like you normally do. Like I just go for the ride, right? Like I really enjoy them.
Oh yeah. We swapped places completely this time because I was just here for the ride. It was like sitting back watching a movie but being that annoying asshole asking all the follow-up questions while the film was going.
Yeah. I mean, if this was a regular episode, we would go into all of that, but we won't. I will write the blog later. I will go into it and I will tell everyone when it's up and available. But it was definitely a lot of fun. The very last quote that I wrote down that I really liked was, life in a slasher film is easy. You just have to know when to die. And I think Lindsay said that. And that's when I knew she was really chaotic. And she was so much more troublesome than they made Izzy out to be. The other thing that I really liked that I wish would have panned out a little bit more was the hints of a queer romance between Izzy and Brittany.
Do you think that had anything to do with Jennifer's body?
I wasn't sure, and I kept thinking, like, I really wasn't sure. I wish that it was developed a little bit more to say yes or no definitively. But again, it was one that I would like to have seen. That's another thing I can give on to Steven, like, develop that a little bit better, re-release the book. Again, so many tropes, so many throwbacks, so much nostalgia for me as a horror, as an 80s slasher horror baby. I truly loved it.
Yeah, I knew that I was going to enjoy it, whether or not I fully grasped what was going on, because it's Stephen Graham Jones.
Right.
But it was also the most lost I've felt reading a book in well over a decade.
I understand that, because I feel like I was somewhat lost with the beauty, but I still really enjoyed the beauty. And it wasn't until we got to talk that I got to understand some of the parts where I was lost at. So I completely get how you were lost in it, because I kept thinking about you and I was like, I wonder if she finished this, because if I was her, I would not have finished this.
I mean, in all honesty, I almost didn't. The only thing getting me through it was imagining you enjoying it.
Yeah, because I would have been like, Sydney, this is why you have to watch this movie, because this is where that reference comes up. And there were some movies that I haven't even watched that I was like, I need to go back and watch them now, because I know it's a reference from that and I didn't watch it.
Okay, well, those will be the ones that we'll watch together, because I need to feel less left out.
You know what? I was telling someone, I was like, the final girl trope seems to be kind of making a resurgence. Mm. Especially like this year, we've got, well, this book wasn't published this year, but there's The Last Final Girl. There's Final Girls by Riley Segar. And then there's Support Group, which I'm going to start that tonight because I think I'm officially done reading all of the 31 Days books. So I'm going to do a little bit of pleasure reading. So I think the final girl is making a resurgence in literature and maybe hopefully in media. We will have to educate, give you some history. We have to do the research.
I can't wait.
I know. And now like we have to do the research on the final girls in the children's literature.
Oh my God. Yes. Because you really did mess me up about that. It's got me thinking about, you know, we'll have to talk about it off air because it's about that course that I was asked to help arrange. But this is like such good timing. So thank you. Although I think that we should probably wrap up this episode because even though I would love to do a full episode of this with you, you know what? Can we just get a coffee date together and you can just tell me all of the things?
We can definitely do that. Because now I'm going to go back and research it and like take my time and read it 10 pages a day and really do my notes better.
Oh my God, I can't wait. That's going to be such a great conversation.
It's going to be a long one.
Good.
All right, guys. We'll see you tomorrow.
Bye, y'all.
Bye.
If you liked listening to us ramble on about horror, subscribe to our podcast and tell your friends. And if you would like to follow us on social media, you can find us on Instagram or Facebook at LLOTL Podcast.
Check out our website by going to lastlibrarontheleft.com. Be sure to visit our About Us page to discover our two truths and a lie. Or if you'd like to send us an email, you can reach us at somethingwicked@lastlibrarontheleft.com.